Hello, and welcome to another episode of SlantCast, the official podcast of Slant Books. My name is Gregory Wolfe, and I am Slant's publisher and editor. Thanks for joining us. This evening, we're delighted to be hosting a book launch event for Living the Liturgy, A Witness, by Luigi Giussani, recently published by Slant. To discuss the book, we're being joined by Professor Timothy O'Malley, who I'll be introducing in just a moment. As always, I want to begin, however, by offering a few brief words that might help to articulate the mission and vision of Slant Books, the host for these podcasts. Over the past few months, I've been doing that primarily through what I call the commonplace book method, because I keep coming across material that highlights not only Slant's raison d'etre, but the urgency of our mission. Along those lines, a recent post on social media put me in mind of one of my favorite quotes, and I realized that this quotation serves as the perfect lead-in to today's podcast. It's from an interview with the great Swedish film director Ingmar Bergman, and it's so fascinating and so apt for our discussion tonight that I hope you won't mind me quoting it at length. Here goes. And this is Ingmar Bergman. "People ask, what are my intentions with my films, my aims? It is a difficult and dangerous question, and I usually give an evasive answer. I try to tell the truth about the human condition, the truth as I see it. This answer seems to satisfy everyone, but it is not quite correct. I prefer to describe what I would like my aim to be. There is an old story of how the Cathedral of Chartres was struck by lightning and burned to the ground. Then thousands of people came from all points of the compass, like a giant procession of ants, and together they began to rebuild the cathedral on its old site. They worked until the building was completed. Master builders, artists, laborers, clowns, noblemen, priests, burghers. But they all remained anonymous, and no one knows to this day who built the Cathedral of Chartres. Regardless of my own beliefs and my own doubts, which are unimportant in this connection, it is my opinion that art lost its basic creative drive the moment it was separated from worship. It severed an umbilical cord and now lives its own sterile life, generating and degenerating itself. In former days, the artist remained unknown, and his work was for the glory of God. He lived and died without being more or less important than other artisans. Eternal values, immortality, and masterpiece were terms not applicable to his case. The ability to create was a gift. In such a world flourished invulnerable assurance and natural humility. Today, the individual has become the highest form and the greatest bane of artistic creation. The smallest wound or pain of the ego is examined under a microscope as if it were of eternal importance. The artist considers his isolation, his subjectivity, his individualism almost holy. Thus we finally gather in one large pen, where we stand and bleat about our loneliness without listening to each other and without realizing that we are encountering each other, smothering each other to death. The individualists stare into each other's eyes and yet deny the existence of each other." And I'm still going with the quote, so bear with me. I'm almost done. "We walk in circles so limited by our own anxieties that we can no longer distinguish between true and false, between the gangster's whim and the purest ideal. Thus, if I am asked what I would like the general purpose of my films to be, I would reply that I want to be one of the artists in the cathedral on the Great Plain. I want to make a dragon's head, an angel, a devil, or perhaps a saint out of stone. It does not matter which. It is the sense of satisfaction that counts. regardless of whether I believe or not, whether I am Christian or not, I would play my part in the collective building of the cathedral." Close quote. I hope you agree that Bergman's words are both evocative and provocative, and they form the ideal introduction to a podcast that examines one of Slant's interests, which might be characterized as religious or theological. But as you'll soon hear on the podcast, we're not interested in academic approaches to the subject. Rather, we're interested in what might be called lived theology, what it might feel like to want to build that cathedral, which means that our books in this vein are firmly grounded in experience, and that their approach is not so much intellectual as poetic and dramatic. And with that, I will now introduce this episode's guest. Timothy P. O'Malley, Professor of the Practice, is the Director of Education at the McGrath Institute for Church Life and Academic Director of the Notre Dame Center for Liturgy. He holds a concurrent appointment in the Department of Theology at the University of Notre Dame. He received his undergraduate degree at the University of Notre Dame, majoring in theology and philosophy. His MTS is in liturgical studies, also from the University of Notre Dame, and he completed a doctorate at Boston College in theology and education. He researches and teaches at Notre Dame in the areas of liturgical sacramental theology, marriage and family, Catholic higher education, catechesis, preaching, and spirituality. He is the author of 9 books on topics related to the liturgy, or CIA, the Eucharist, sacramental theology, marriage and family, and liturgical formation. Professor O'Malley is married and has 2 children. He is originally from Knoxville, Tennessee. Professor Timothy O'Malley, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, thanks so much for having me.
Well, we appreciate your taking the time to be with us today as we talk about Luigi Giussani's Living the Liturgy, A Witness, a book that is part of a kind of ongoing interest on Slant's part in works of philosophy and theology. Maybe not our main focus, as we're a literary press, but we approach the subject of religion without the kind of hermeneutic of suspicion, I think, that has become pretty ingrained in the kind of high culture world that we move and live in. And I think a lot of people are actually grateful for that there is an openness and an awareness on the part of a literary press to this aspect of human experience. So that's how I'd sort of like to start building up to our topic today, and that's to maybe chat a little bit about, you know, your thoughts on the topic of sort of liturgy as something that has some deep historical anthropological roots in a kind of marriage of language, gesture, visual, symbol, and the sacred, and that somehow these two things have really been deeply part of our history, and even if maybe that seems somewhat archaic to us now, I think even a contemporary poet would say, you know, that they have this bardic tradition in mind, this sense that the artist is somebody who does, in a sense, ask the big questions and perhaps, as Flannery O'Connor put it, intrude upon the timeless. So as a student of liturgy and of history, what are some of the kind of key ideas that might bear out what I've just tossed out there, hoping to hear if you have some thoughts on it?
Yeah, it's a great question. It's one the 20th century is happy to have thought about. There really is a kind of recognition in the 20th century that, you know, what we would call a world permeated or made present with God, you know, that the sacraments in the liturgy have a particular way of responding to that. There's a kind of natural sacramentality, let's call it that, right? That we're faced with involvement in the world and passage of time, and we find gestures or ways of marking this time or making meaning, and that's an intrinsically sort of human thing to do. Now, you know, Christians and actually Jewish folk Christians and they'll find a way, right, not only to just do those gestures, but to understand that those gestures connect to a history, right, a history that those things are taken up in, you know, for the faith case of a Christian in Christ and, you know, baptism, right, water cleanses, it blesses, it gives life, right, it quenches thirst, but it also kills. If you ask anyone from New Orleans, water is actually kind of highly dangerous. I mean, you actually find this in some of the short stories of Flannery O'Connor, like the sort of ambiguity of water. And, you know, I think that that dimension of liturgy is just there, right? It's taking up this kind of natural sacramentality, but you know, to sort of move along, right, it's taking up that natural sacramentality and showing how it's redeemed and how creation is returned and restored to itself. So, you know, the history of liturgy is really the history of art and poetry too. It's the history of us writing things in praise of God. It's the history of hymnody and of drama and of painting and all those dimensions, right? Because in this worship of God, it seems the arts have been intrinsic to it from the beginning.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the Judeo-Christian tradition is such a narrative tradition. It's so embedded in storytelling, you know, right from the very beginning. And I guess maybe the classic sort of test case for all of this, I remember studying the origins of drama in Western history. And it's pretty well known these days that that in the Middle Ages, you know, the liturgies of the Passion, which we're in the midst of, are about to be in the midst of right now, as we're recording this in Holy Week and coming up to the Passion, these long recitations of the gospel sections included the idea of putting figures up in, you know, in the clear story and around the church, and sort of the dramatic element of that began to then move outside of the church. And she had this interesting dynamic of the inside versus the outside, what was in the public square, having an organic relationship to what was in, you know, the sacred space. And so all this has been traced, you know, in terms of the rise of theater, of plays, of kind of modern drama had its origin there. So, you know, that sense of the inherently cosmic dimension of what literature asks, you know, what are the big questions, are the same as of what the religious narrative asks us.
Yeah, no, that's well said. I mean, my favorite, the first drama is this sort of quem quaeritis, which is, you know, who do you seek on Easter Sunday? And, you know, I have these monks that are sort of trying to perform this sort of basic, you know, resurrection narrative, which of course leads it into this great poetic sequence or poem that occurs after the gospel on Easter. And right from this, you have the arrival of like the great mystery plays of the Feast of Corpus Christi, which extend out, right? You know, there's even sort of narrative that Shakespeare finds his own sort of dramatic tone emerging from these, you know, York Corpus Christi plays and the kind of popular dimension of it. And so, you know, I was, I teach liturgy, and I think a lot of people think liturgy is about rubrics and doing the right things, and it's kind of a sort of stuffy thing. But my actual interest in liturgy is really the way that it shapes a culture, and a culture then gets taken up into the church's worship. It goes both ways, and It's kind of fun to do the history of that.
Yeah. So it's no coincidence that the author of the book we're talking about, Father Luigi Giussani, is someone who greatly prized literature especially, but also all the art forms, and was well known to, you know, quote, well, certainly the great Italian poets like Dante and Leopardi and Pavese and so on and so forth. In fact, he tells a story about encountering the romantic poet Leopardi, who's, I guess, kind of a little bit of an equivalent to, say, a Wordsworth or, you know, the romantic poets of the British 19th century. And being so struck that he more or less stopped doing everything else for like a month. And this was when he was already in seminary as a young, you know, pretty much like a boy man, but really at the outset of his own sense of his journey as a soul in this world. And so, of course, he also quotes T.S. Eliot all the time, Chesterton and others. You know, he's Italian, so he writes in this very rhetorical style. I know you've probably encountered it, you know, in this book and elsewhere. It's maybe a little less linear than our Anglo-American style of prose. But have you appreciated, at least to some extent, his writing, even if it's perhaps a little challenging for, you know, the Anglo-American culturally formed individual to parse?
Yes, I actually do appreciate it. I have subjected my students to it. I teach our intro theology course, and I've assigned the religious sense to my students, and sort of other Giussani, precisely actually because of what you're saying, is that you know, it's not linear, it's circling around a theme, and but once you're attentive to that theme that it's circling around, you can see the kind of full the full sources that are being brought in actually help you appreciate the kind of particular mystery or account of reality that is under examination in a new kind of way. And so, yeah, I mean, I appreciate the prose, and I think it does something different than a kind of mere didactic, especially in the liturgy, in the text that we're talking about, where you simply kind of, the temptation has been to sort of run through a kind of historical narrative alone, or this is how this developed and this led to this, or this prayer says this. And I think what Giussani helps us to do is understand the kind of humanistic dimensions of religion, of Catholicism, of the church's worship. I always remember when I was reading his biography, Giussani's biography, how clear it was that, you know, this was someone who in seminary at Milan had actually received the kind of education and formation that led to a real sort of cultural and literary engagement. It was always impressive to me. And then to read in this text, right, that he brought that to bear on the liturgy was exciting for me, who am not a native reader of Italian. So I rely on those translations.
Absolutely. I should probably mention at this point that along the lines of the way journalists sometimes rightly make a little note of transparency, that I am a follower of Father Giussani in the sense that I belong to the lay movement that he founded, Communion Liberation. So I'm certainly not disinterested in all of this. But I think what attracted me, you know, to the movement originally, to Father Giussani's thought, was precisely his insistence that that religious faith and Christianity in particular is fundamentally dramatic. That is, before it is doctrine, before it is, you know, moral rules and ethics, before it's even pious practices, it is an encounter that becomes an event. And, you know, it's perhaps easy to parody those words at times, but really at its root, I think it's an important corrective to the way that religion sometimes gets reduced certainly critics of religion, but also practitioners often do reduce it to the right thoughts and the right rules, forgetting that the source of all that is a relationship.
Yeah, and I think that Giussani enters right into this early 20th framework with this retrieval of this kind of dimension of religion, of Catholicism is at hand, right? There is a distinctive sense that Christianity is encounter, that divine revelation is an event. It's the drama of salvation, of God becoming human, of God redeeming men and women, right, through the incarnation, but also through the sort of passion, death, and resurrection. And, you know, there's in the 20th century, liturgical texts and liturgical things are very interested in how this is made present to us in the moment, right? And I think what you're hinting at, right, throughout Living Liturgy, his book, is that it provides an answer to this question of how this becomes present, right? We have to enter into the drama, right? The drama is there and unfolds in the text and the practices of the liturgy. But there's, you could imagine watching a play or hearing a poem and getting nothing out of it. But I think what he's inviting us into is that sort of subjective entrance into the mystery that is involved, and into that encounter, which, or into that event, I should note, that, you know, encounter that becomes event for us. I have to admit, I teach Giussani and I read Giussani, but I'm not a member of the lay community. So I sometimes struggle with the vocabulary, getting it exactly right. So I'm always helpful when Communion Liberation or CL folk correct me when I don't use the right words.
Oh, well, listen, if we're honest with ourselves, we worry half the time whether we're getting it right or not. But, you know, the great thing is that Father Giussani's own, you know, quote, sentiments on these matters was, you know, the terms help, but the terms aren't, you know, the end. They're a means to get us to this experience, you know, to look at our experience, our human experience, as the center of the place where we really need to start, not, you know, we encounter history and the church teaching and the church practices only ultimately by understanding ourselves, like understanding what motivates us, what we care about, what, you know, what the heart is really all about. So we're just as confused as you are, but we approach that confusion with a sense of mercy and I think maybe, I hope, good humor. So getting to the book itself, I mean, a lot of books on liturgy these days are about liturgical reform and liturgical, what's been called the liturgy wars, different factions fighting. We know that it's an ongoing issue in really almost every denomination and religious world, how we pray together, how we celebrate the sacred together. Are we doing it in ways that are out of date, or are we not being current enough? I think you, in a recent interview, you said that the great thing about, you know, the approach in this book is that it doesn't get involved in all of that. It really goes straight to first principles. And I think you said it's a book not about liturgical reform first, but a liturgical way of living, you said. Can you expand on that a little?
You know, as Catholics, it's important as a Catholic to live out the mystery of Christ's life in one's own life. And the privileged way that a Catholic does that, right, is in the liturgy. And this has been taken up, right, to all sorts of arguments. Should it be in Latin? It's not sacred enough. Where's your chant? Or actually, why are you using chants? I can't believe you're using chants. And this kind of argument is distracted from the fundamental purpose of what those reforms, whether we're talking about vernacular or, you know, simplifying in some sense the Mass, or making more clear the links of the liturgical year. The purpose of this wasn't for more liturgy, right? To have new books that would tell you what to do, but that there was an actual kind of participation in Christ's own life, and that the liturgy would shape how we go about living, right? The fact that on Christmas, the Word becomes flesh, right? The incarnation unfolds, and that therefore that changes forever what it means to be a human being, that he dies and rises again, that we engage in certain gestures in the liturgy. All of this is intended to shape a form of life, a kind of wisdom. And I think what I read in the text was a kind of answer to a lot of these endless liturgical debates, which is, you know, whether you're attending a mass in the case of a Catholic that you find gorgeous, right, aesthetically pleasing, or you're attending a liturgy that you find aesthetically, well, complicated, right? The same invitation is to enter into the history of the of Jesus Christ, to let that history shape you and to live it out. And so I think in that sense, it's a profoundly, you know, I guess modern is the wrong word for it, but a profoundly post-Vatican II, post, reform of the liturgy work, because it really focuses on shaping that kind of response to the mystery of love that's given. Mm.
Now, I know that, you know, this idea of participation really is central, isn't it? And I think it's precisely in maybe defining what we mean by participation that a lot of the debates originate in that. Because, I mean, you could argue that, and has been argued, that a greater sense of participation occurs when we're more present to our immediate culture, our immediate issues of society, of politics, of the day, and the participation involves just our being more with it in a sense, and not following ancient rubrics and ancient narratives. And in the introduction to the book, the Italian writer. Broski says that this debate kind of reduces itself to, you know, treating liturgy as archaeology, as something, you know, fixed and historical only, and then reducing liturgy to sociology, trying to make it, you know, too current. What do you feel Giussani helps us to do to somehow avoid those extremes and live in a more vital center?
Yeah, I mean, I think so it's not archaeology, it's not liturgical history. Here's the origins of Christmas or the origins of the Eucharistic worship of the church. Nor, for that matter, as you note, does it sort of say, okay, the Eucharist is just one of a particular kind of sociological rituals that we have performed throughout time that lead to communion. But I think for almost all of Giussani, and I'd love to know what you think actually in return, and I think what's placed at the heart is involvement in the life and mystery of Jesus Christ, right? You used the phrase earlier, which I'm going to return to, which is that, the encounter must become an event, right? And that's what unfolds in liturgy, but it's the event of Christ's salvation for us, the event of, you know, you're not talking about, like, there is an action of God here, right? This is not sort of mere sociological kind of performance, but of course it's always done. And I think, Giussani's consistency on this point, it's done in this communion or community of those who are engaged in the act of worship, right? So, there are those, for example, that say, well, you know, worship is really, a horizontal dimension of worship is really about the community, but the vertical is about God. And that's never true for Giussani, right? Because we come in communion, right? It's Jesus who gathers the disciples, and now we are gathered around Jesus as the sort of echoing of those disciples in communion with one another. Engage, though, in this act of worship in which Christ becomes present and active in our life, and we give that act of fundamental gratitude in return, right? That is the result of that. I'm always moved in some of the other sort of works that Giussani has noted that he describes the Eucharist in particular as this fundamental posture of gratitude or gift that is it the essence of what it means to be human, right? And that's what the liturgy really forms us in. So that's kind of what I think he does. Not only does he do that, but he also does it so beautifully and invites us in humanely. Like sometimes I work with undergraduates and they think liturgy is really about these fights. But there's a kind of, you know, when we were talking about the literary dimension, it makes it humane and to see this sort of existential import of worship in all of its particularities. So yeah, I think that's what he did for me. And really great liturgical classics have done for me in the 20th century. They rescued me from, you know, either being a traditionalist, right, wanting to return to some archaic form, or thinking the liturgy is just what a particular parish does that I like.
Yeah, absolutely. And I, you know, I think another aspect of that, or another dimension of that, that really struck me when I, you know, was reading this book in the manuscript form is, you know, it's easy at times to think that liturgy is fundamentally what we do, or to emphasize it differently, what we do. We come up with words, we string them together, we say them, we sing them. And of course, that's true, but it also takes place within not just a one-way approach, right? There's a sense of dialogue, and this goes to the very heart of the mystery of religious experience, that we speak, but we're also spoken to. And I think any writer, any poet, any creative writer understands this to some extent, even if they refuse or scorn the religious dimension. There's always this mystery of what I consciously create, construct out of my willpower and myself, and what I receive and what I hear, and that meeting place, that's ultimately a kind of sacramental right there. You know, I do something on my end, but I'm met by a force, a personality, a presence that's also doing something. And that all goes all the way back to the heart of what scripture is, right? It's a human thing, but it's not a human thing. And we're not going to solve that, you know, today, but we know that that's the kind of mystery that we live inside of, to some extent, whatever our religious beliefs. And the passage that really whammied me in this book is from Giussani's preface to the book, and he says something pretty strong for him. He's kind of a gentle guy in most ways, but he got pretty strong when he said, "Instead of understanding the discourse of God as the new language that shatters our human wisdom, we have taken the word of God as support for our wisdom, or even treated the Bible in an accommodating sense. That is, when a phrase is not interpreted according to our ear, to the ear of our mentality, of our culture, instead of searching to make our mentality, our culture, adequate to the meaning, to the communication, to the witness that sprang from this phrase." So I don't know if that helps, you know, you to riff on that at all, but the idea of liturgy is ultimately being in some mysterious way dialogue, and we have to remember that in that dialogue, God is speaking to us in some way.
Yeah, I think that's so, that's the essential thing. And in fact, that's part of the fight, right? So a misinterpretation of liturgy, of the Greek word, is liturgia, or the work of the people. And a lot of this emphasis, therefore, was on our work. But actually, liturgia was God's work upon God's people. And so, right, the first thing is the convoking or the call or the fundamental gratuity or gift that's given at the very beginning. And I think what you helped me think through today was why so often poets in particular find themselves attracted eventually often to sort of sacramentality or worship. Because to really gaze at the created order aright, even that which is most horrific, and to see some sort of primordial call or gift that's given in the midst of that, right? And then to offer, in essence, your own return or co-creative gift to that, right? Because you create the poem, you engage in the sculpture or sort of the art, you engage in sort of painting in light of this is in some sense your response to this original event or gift. It's also why the really good poets also are fundamentally dissatisfied with their return gift, right? I mean, it's incomplete. It doesn't capture that primordial sort of call. And I don't think that's just merely subjective, right? It's not some sort of like, well, it doesn't capture my feelings, right? But it actually doesn't capture that primordial evocation or call that one receives. And that, I think, is what liturgy should train really all Christians in. Training is probably a bad word. Let's form or attuned to, so that, you know, a really good Christian for the liturgy should gain a really good interest in literature and all the ways that artists have offered that kind of return gift to the primordial evocation or call that they've received, even if it's kind of messy and bloody and kind of hard to read. Sometimes those are the ones that are most important.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, most great artists, I think, in moments of humility will, you know, say that what they do emerges out of a love, not just of their ability to make, but of their reverence for the material that they receive as a given, in a sense, you know, the nature of wood or marble or human language with all its rich historical, you know, connotation and etymology and historical, you know, baggage for better or worse. And that there's this interaction between what is, you know, the making and the materials, what's given to us, what we experience as revelation of the way the world is, and we respond to that. I think of the great 20th century Anglo-Welsh Catholic poet David Jones, who said to me one of the more revealing things about the sacraments when he said more or less, and I'm paraphrasing here probably rather badly, but he said, "Have you ever really thought that about why the Eucharist is bread and wine? It bread and wine, why isn't it wheat and grapes?" In a sense, you know, why is it these made things? And he said that's because, you know, our human making is met by God's making, and it's in that mysterious place, that juncture, that we experience something of a world within the world, of transcendence, if you will, to some extent. And I think ultimately liturgy at its best puts us in that space, you know, puts us in that space of the in-between, our speaking and our being spoken to and addressed, because we discover who we are when there's, you know, to go back to Buber, you know, the I and the thou. You know, I and this is Giussani to a T, my I is generated by somebody, a you that addresses me, in a sense.
Yes, that's exactly right. Just a very close connection between the sort of, in Latin originally, right, the sort of words for culture, cult, and cultivate, right? That this is the marvel of the, I suppose this is the marvel in my assessment of this Christian God of ours, that the I does address the you and make the you into a thou, right? A sort of co-participant and a creator in this work, and didn't need to, right? I suppose that's the gratuity of it, right? If I was God, I probably wouldn't have. I probably had a better vision myself, but that there's some sort of sense of outpouring that I think responds to it. And I suppose that's where the sheer gratuity and gift, right? For, you know, I would imagine as an artist, I would, and I'm not an artist, I'm a mediocre writer, but I think as an artist that to return to that sort of constant memory of the gratuity of that gift would write it upon your identity. This is another dimension in which I think Giussani captures this, is liturgy is formative of that sense of gratuity that we constantly emerge, you know, that the temptation of life is to forget the source of it as event. Other ideologies surface, and yet ritual prayer, liturgical prayer, brings us back again and again to the source of that gratuity, that gift. It writes us itself upon our bones in a particular kind of way and in our bodies. So I think there's a lot of work to be done, in my assessment, between liturgy and, right, the aesthetic sensibility and the artistic sensibility, which I think has only been tapped into. But I'm grateful that Giussani has helped me think again through it.
Yeah, and, you know, I think it's only fair at this point that we say that the book doesn't just treat liturgy in an abstract way. I mean, it precisely because of its emphasis on liturgy's relationship to our everyday experience, Giussani does say, you know, that when you respond to the encounter, when it really becomes an event for you, it does change you, right? It does change you. And he says that's the essence of morality. Morality is that which represents my attitude or stance or approach to the world. How do I look at others? How do I relate to them in the light of what this event tells me about myself? So, and I thought about that even more when in the interview on the book, you said that you said we have too often reduced the liturgy to a thin sense of participation. What are people doing? Father Giussani says to us, who are you becoming? And that immediately for me tied into this question of, you know, liturgy as having, as you said, a formative, it does shape who we are, who we become, how we live. Can you talk a little bit more about, in a sense, the way that liturgy forms our moral sense?
Yeah, I mean, so I think what Giussani is properly retrieving, and this occurred a good deal in the 20th century, was a recognition that liturgy was connected to a morality. It was often Romans 12 was returned to in scripture, make of your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Lord. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your minds. And right, this transforming of one's mind, the way that our bodies exercise or function or remember, it was an authentic retrieval of, like, the liturgy wasn't just like pleasant rite, but it was the full sort of way that the human person should live in the world and behave and act. I'm always reminded in Exodus, right, that before the Ten Commandments are given, right, what it says is remember, right, that this is the God who rescued you from Israel, right? So it's first God's action and then our response. And so morality, right, is in some sense how we worship in return to God, is the proper use of our bodies, of our wills, of who we are. And so I think so too, right? Liturgy is authentic morality, which means it forms us in this act of praise, but then it also therefore means that in the course of our daily life, it must become this occasion or art of praise and return, right? And to make it really quite practical for myself, right? I have young children and I'm a professor. And it means that, right, the act of, you know, when I went to Mass today, right, and I said, lift up your hearts. We have lifted them up to the Lord. And that means that I did that at Mass, but that means I have to lift up my heart or my whole being to the Lord in those other relationships, in those other encounters, or when we're done, for example, with this, like finishing bathing my children, is part of this sort of exercise of mundane contemplative praise that is supposed to be part of my life. And right, and that my response to that is essential to who I am. So that morality, right? So it's morality, but of course, Giussani doesn't mean it like in the, as you know, but I'm, as your listener may not, like it doesn't mean like oughts and noughts, but it means how we behave, who we are, our full embodied involvement and participation, human participation in the world. And I think that's what ideally the liturgy should do. If we're attentive to it and contemplate it, as I think Giussani invited us to do.
Yeah. Yeah. And of course, for him, in a sense, morality isn't about following a rule. It's like honoring a relationship. Like it's how you want to treat your friends, in a sense, including the possibility of there being a big friend out there, a friendly, you know, force of the universe. So yes, very much so. And I think to help our listeners, the book does get practical pretty quickly in the sense that it gets specific. It follows in the first section the sequence, you might say the drama of the Mass, and then pursues that further, in a sense, elaborates it through the church year. So do you have any thoughts just about how he goes about opening up for us a little bit the depth and the beauty of the Mass and the liturgical year?
Yeah, I mean, what I got when I read this, it was reminded me a little bit of, you know, in the medieval period, there would be these like lay Mass primers that were intended to help you sort of pray better. And they'd often mix actually hilariously like poetry and other sort of dimensions to sort of help you with. And I think this is what's happening, right? Like each gesture of the Mass or each word receives appropriate attention, right? Linked to, I think, as you said, human experience. And then, of course, the liturgical year, right? In some sense, these are the dimensions of the liturgy most accessible to your average Christian, right? They go to Sunday Mass, and then they celebrate the church year, right? They do Christmas and they Easter and Sunday and things like that. And so I think that's, you asked me earlier, you know, how is it living a liturgical life? I mean, I guess that's it, right? It's lived in between the sort of Eucharistic worship, which is normative for Christian life, and all those particular gestures and words that are said, but also, you know, marking of time. And I guess, right, that is highly practical. And I guess I'm grateful for that marking of time. I was reading part of this while I was creating a course on the liturgical year for our own students. And I was just marked by the kind of propheticness of the ways that he invites us to mark time through, you know, through the seasons of the year of Christmas and Easter, and to mark it in very human experiential ways.
You might say that part of any liturgy is what you might call a kind of wholesome repetition, or the idea that by, you know, going year by year through the same experiences, the same seasons, the same focuses of what each liturgical season asks of us, penitence or joy or some combination thereof, or awareness, you know, of the beauty of what is also called ordinary time, that in that repetition, we are formed, we are shaped, and that it, you know, hopefully doesn't become what the Bible calls vain repetition, but truly liberating repetition. Like any discipline is meant to free you, not constrain you. But it's, you know, certainly our culture seems to tell us at times that, you know, to be free is to be free of rules, or be free of constraint of any kind. And I think liturgy offers, you know, a really important counterpoint to that sort of cultural prejudice that we inherit.
Yeah, I mean, and I think the way that Giussani, so certainly, right, ritual writes itself upon us. There's actually a great text on this that I think is especially, there's a text, and suddenly now it's not coming to my mind, of course, but that makes a distinction in ritual between like ritual in a kind of performative or subjunctive mode, right? And ritual in a sincere mode. Sincere ritual is like, okay, I first have to come to this idea and then I'll do it, right? I first love my wife. I make the decision that I love my wife, and then I will give her flowers. Whereas living in the subjunctive is to say, actually, I'll give flowers. And in the sort of embodied acts I'll live in a world as if, right? It actually reminds me a lot of Giussani's language of hypothesis that he uses when he describes, right, the sort of Christian proposal, right? I'll live in this world as if. And the more you live in that world as if, right, the more that world becomes real to you, right? And you recognize its truth. And which, right, I think he very closely, this is also in the very beginning of the text when he's discussing the Mass. Right, by following the parts of the Mass, he writes, we'll be able to comprehend the characteristics of every action of our lives, which should be the characteristics of every relationship, of every day, of every project. Note, he says, by intelligently following, right? So eventually we do actually have to understand what we're doing to live into that as if, and then to enter more deeply into it, right? I think that's what being an adult starts to be like in life. My children do all sorts of things happily, sort of by ritual, but one day they're going to ask the question, why, or for what end, or how is this going to make me happy, as they get more angst-ridden. I hope that's the question they ask. This is the kind of thing he's doing, right? So it isn't, yes, we subjunctively enter into it, but we have to ask the questions that make sense of it. What does this mean for my life here and now? That's the question that has to be asked.
Absolutely. And I think in some ways we've come full circle in the conversation, because what is literature, what is art, if not in a sense as if embodied in paint, in words, in movement, in marble, and so many other different forms, that that all great art is in some sense this tension or dialogue between the is and the as if, and they need each other. You can't break loose, you know, from one or the other. They have to inform each other, otherwise they become deformed in some way. You also put me in mind, I may be horribly corrupting this, but my brain tells me the Cardinal Newman once said, faith follows action. In a fundamental sense, very similar to what you were saying, that I don't stand around, you know, suddenly deciding to believe in the spiritual, the transcendent, you know, the mysterious. I encounter it and I begin to act in a certain way, and that action, that putting myself in motion, as Father Giussani would say, is what reveals to me what I believe, in a sense. Like, it's not an abstract or a priori decision I come to. It's looking at myself as I'm living in the world. And I think at its root, that's what this book is really just saying in so many different ways.
Yeah, no, that's well said. I appreciate that last point. I appreciate, again, the return to the arts and that living in a world as if. And it's just, this conversation has been really illuminating for me, because it's just made me return again to the relationship between literature and poetry and painting and music and really the church's worship for me, which is my object of study, and to say that, yeah, there is something about it that allows, you know, I'm reminded of icons that allow us, that have a kind of realism to them, Orthodox icons, but they also have a surprising non-realism and a world as if, right? You know, John the Baptist has a head, but he's holding his head. And, right, like that kind of way enters us into the event. And I suppose that's, I guess what you've helped me understand is why I liked reading this book so much and why it meant a good deal to me.
Well, listen, Tim, you're very generous to say that. I learned so much from your interviews, that you've given on this and everything that you said today. I'm incredibly grateful. I know how busy your schedule is. I don't take it for granted that you carved out this time to be with us. Thank you so much, Tim, for joining us today.
Oh, thanks so much. It really is a gift for me, so thanks.
Living the Liturgy is available for purchase in cloth-bound, paperback, and ebook editions through all major online retailers, and also your bookstore, if you just ask. If you go to the book's webpage at slantbooks.org, you can find links to several of those outlets, including bookshop.org. The best way to keep up with our new and recent releases is to visit our website and sign up for Slantwise, our occasional e-newsletter. Just go right to the bottom of any webpage and you'll find where you can subscribe to Slantwise. You can also follow us on social media. Please also check our blog, Close Reading, for illuminating posts on the intersection between literature, imagination, and their capacity to form mind and heart. In May, Slant will publish its next title, the poetry collection Matters for You Alone by Leslie Williams. Matters for You Alone is a spiritual investigation of friendship, its shape, stresses, and blames, and its absolute necessity. The book takes its title from Jean-Pierre de Caussade's spiritual classic, Abandonment to Divine Providence, as it strives to interpret everyday encounters and events, the domestic, the mundane, in light of the eternal. Powerful and powerless, made perfect in weakness, the speaker in these poems is fractured and dazzling, abject and hurried, courageous and fallen, you and me. At times playful, at others deadly serious, these poems ask important questions about our friends. What is the lifespan of a friendship, and how might we celebrate its glories? How have our friends made us who we are? Quote, as seen in Fresco's Now Effaced, says it this way, we're taught to love by someone, a series of them, each seeking a brief shelter as the spirit searches for more capacious seas. Close quote. A friend holds a special status, not exactly family, but often with deeper resonances of meaning and responsibility, and especially choice. When friendships go wrong, how can we mend and heal? As way leads on to way, how can forgiveness hold the sacred memory of others and their indelible marks on us? This book is for anyone who wants to reflect on the people in our lives for whom we've received instruction, correction, inspiration, and joy. You can now subscribe to Slantcast through all the major podcast outlets, including Spotify, Apple, Audible, and many others. Please remember that none of this would be possible without your tax-deductible donations. You ensure that books like Living the Liturgy can be published and reach a world of readers hungry for literary craft and enduring themes, books that do research into the human. To support our work, just go to slantbooks.org and click on donate. Finally, remember to tell all the truth, but tell it slant. Thanks again, and see you next time.